So good morning, everybody. Such a great show. I don't know if you guys had as much fun as I did. I'm trying to figure out the best place for my notes here. So this is pitching Infosec in the boardroom when the customers don't care. We're going to talk about some research that I conducted. And we're going to go through some tips and things. And so if you want to take pictures of the slides, you're more than welcome to. But just so you know, the slides are available on rsaconference.com. And at the end of the slide, or end of the presentation, there's going to be a slide that you can get access to not only everything here, but a bunch of additional resources that I've prepared for you. So if you want to do that, that's fine. But otherwise, you can wait. So quick show of hands, how many of you guys have taken at least one business class? This is a lot of you, right? So see if this sounds familiar, right? Anybody who goes to business school, you know, they'll tell you about this, that they learn about this utopian society that's inside the middle management of corporations, big and small, right? And the problems are really thought through. Solutions are presented, they're weighed, plans are made to solve these problems, and it's just done in an organized and orderly fashion. Does that sound like any place you guys work? It sure doesn't sound like any place I've ever worked. So I wanted to show you something that's it's personal to me. So you think about how change is supposed to happen, and it's supposed to be orderly. It's supposed to happen because, you know, we have all those problems we're trying to solve, and we do this in an orderly way. So if you guys don't know what this is a very early sketch drawing from Jørn Utzon, and he was the guy who designed the Sydney Opera House, right? So this is one of the first sort of sketches and drawings, and if you haven't been there and haven't done the tour, if you get to go to Sydney, definitely go do the tour. I've done it twice. I'd probably do it again. But as things happen, you know, things start to get fleshed out a little bit more, right? This drawing looks a little better. We start to figure out how we can actually construct this thing. As the designers didn't really know how we're going to construct this. They had to sort of make it up as they went along. And then, you know, we get the beautiful opera house that we see today. But unfortunately, it's not really how it often happens, right? It's usually because somebody, is yelling about change or something is wrong, right? So it could be that an employee or government official and an auditor might fall into that bucket. We've all had to deal with, a lot of us are here because of compliance reasons or controls that need to be put in place. Somebody's telling us we have to do something. But oftentimes it's the customer. And businesses, as per the model, they're designed to swap product and services in exchange for monetary consideration. So if the people with the money decide to go elsewhere, then the business is kind of in trouble, right? So, or maybe in simpler words, cash is king. He who has the cash is the king, which would be the customer in a lot of cases. So let's look at some research. Now, this research was conducted over a period of about 2 weeks. We collected responses from 1,000 consumers, and the rules to be included in the survey are there. 18 to 70, had to be in the United States, must have at least one credit card or debit card, must have shopped at one of the breach merchants. I'm gonna show you the list. Like we presented 15 merchants that had suffered a breach. So you can sort of think, if you think about the timing, we had lots of data to work with, right? 2014 was a pretty tough year for retail, and we used that data set. They were pulled from privacyrights.org, and so in order for them to go to the next step, they must have shopped at one of those breached merchants. Otherwise, they were excluded from the survey. So we asked their awareness. We asked about their behaviors after the breach. And that's really important. I'll tell you why in a minute. But you know, I guess it's really not a spoiler alert. The customers really don't care. Their behaviors, they don't care. But you know, I'm sure that you're saying, you know, hang on a second, Branden. I've read stories or read studies that say the opposite. Okay, so keep that in mind as we go through this, right? Consumers are going to demonstrate attitudes by spend. If a consumer or manager of a business dislikes a company enough, they'll make a change, right? So think about it in your head. How many of you have made a change in a vendor, personal life or professional life, because you didn't like something that vendor did? I did last week, right? So oftentimes it does require financial harm, right? Because in some cases you think about switching costs. So I'll use banking as an example, not because I work for one, because I think it's a real good example. It's going to take a lot for you to switch banks, right? Because like all your online bill pay, your paychecks, everything to get that set up, like, all right, fine, maybe I'll just deal with this, you know, bad customer service I got a couple times. But if they start charging you a bunch of fees, I bet you're going to change banks pretty quick. So it sometimes requires financial harm. And just because a consumer spends today obviously doesn't mean they'll spend tomorrow. So let's talk about the problems of the existing research. So this whole thing sort of started off when I was working at First Data, and I'd declared war on any sort of FUD marketing material that I saw in any, you know, any of these things, any of the papers that went out. And in fact, just another one. Has anybody heard out on the show floor, we don't have to mention any names, but has anybody heard a vendor on the show floor say that a breach is bad for your brand? I heard it yesterday, right? Not so sure I believe that. So many studies suggest that they will defect if a company suffers a security breach, right? In this particular case, the reason that I kicked off this research, this one particular fact that I found in some literature, it was actually a misquoted fact, but it was from a, it's an alternate fact, right? And it was from a very prominent research firm. And that research, the way it was presented, it said 70% of consumers will not return to a merchant after they've been breached. And then right next to it, there's a Home Depot logo and a Target logo and Neiman Marcus and TJX. And I looked at that and I said, I'm pretty sure those guys are doing fine. Like, I don't think that number's right. Well, it turns out they had it backwards. It's actually 30% was one in the study. That was the number in the study. But even still, 30%? Those guys' revenues keep going up. Like, I'm not sure that that's correct. But I've seen these numbers from respected vendors and respected research firms. Won't name any names. But here's the problem, and here's why this research is flawed and what was different about what we did. They used a term, a technique called effective forecasting. Effective forecasting is going to ask you about a hypothetical event and then ask your opinion on what you think about that hypothetical event. So as an example, if you know, we've all been walking around, the streets have been crowded all around San Francisco. If somebody was asking a poll and said, hey, excuse me, I have one question I'd like to ask you, and for whatever reason you stop, I don't know, maybe you're curious, and he says, I'd like to ask you, if you saw a crime happening right there, 20 feet in front of you, would you call the police? We're supposed to be good people, right? We will, yeah, of course I'll call the police, right? Because that's a bad thing and I don't want that to happen. And you know, I would hope somebody would do that for me. But we know that that's not true, right? There's a thing called the bystander effect. When we observe this incident happening, this thing happening, people assume somebody else is going to call. So even though that person said, yes, I will call the police, and if I'm recording that down and then I say, hey, on a survey of 1,000 people in San Francisco, 89% said they'd call police. We all know the number is way, way lower than that. Maybe lower than 5. So here's another example. So what if I told you that a prominent bottled water company was dumping toxins into the South China Sea? It sounds pretty bad, right? We're supposed to love the environment. Would you buy from that company? So I think most of you would probably say, no, of course not, because I don't want to support somebody who's dumping toxins into the South China Sea. I don't know about you guys, maybe it's the lights. I'm a little warm up here. Let's just say it's really warm in here. Everybody's sweating. The session's over. Everybody clapped, because that was a great session, right? You walk outside, and you're looking for water, and out there you see 4 coolers full ice cold water. I mean, it's because it's hot, right? It's beating up on those bottles, and it's from that company. Are you going to grab one? Probably. Okay. Right, we just did that. So, which breaches did we show people? So here's the list. Obviously, there's a few up there that I'm sure everybody knows about. There's a few repeat offenders, too, I can see right off the top of my head. And there was a couple up there that I didn't actually know about. So some of them were like, oh, I didn't realize they suffered a breach. But these are all fairly, you know, there's obviously a couple really big ones, but they're all fairly significant. When we looked at these merchants to put in, we wanted to make sure we had multi-state sort of, it could have been regional, it could have been, you know, or national brand, but we wanted to try to make sure that we had a good coverage because we're picking anybody in the US. Okay, so when we asked about their awareness, like, I don't think there's any surprise here, right? And, you know, the line forms to the left for everybody else. I just want to use this really powerful laser one time. Okay, that was fun. So Target and Home Depot, right? We all remember those, but you know, all these other ones people really didn't have much awareness of. In fact, 13% had awareness of 0 breaches, even though they'd shopped at some of these stores. So now let's talk about how many defected, right? Because this is the money shot, right? There's got how many people of those 30% that were supposed to leave actually left, okay? So for those who said they had not shopped at one of the retailers after the breach, the top reason was, I was not a regular at that store, okay? 16% went to a more convenient competitor. That means that the Home Depot was 9 miles away and Lowe's was 7 miles away. And those are basically the same store except one's orange and one's blue. So I'm gonna go 7 miles instead of 9 miles, okay? 8% moved, I don't live there anymore. 6% or 59% respondents said they defected to a secure competitor or just never returned because of the breach. So 6%, I still think that number's high. I think people were maybe not, I don't know, 59 out of 1,000. That's not 30%. That's not 25% or whatever the study that was released early last year said. Most return within 3 months, and they probably pay with a credit card. So, and here's really the thing I was thinking about when I saw that original, that study note. So picture yourself, you're a young parent, you've got a young one at home, it's 9 o'clock on a Saturday night, you ran out of diapers. Target's the closest store. Where are you gonna go? You're gonna go to Target. You're gonna get diapers, you're gonna get a six pack, and you're gonna pay with your credit card. So, consumers don't care. So what did we learn? Of the consumers polled, the vast majority did not care one single bit. They may have said they cared, they may have told their friends that they're really upset, but when it comes down to voting with their dollars, they went back to the store and they spent money with that merchant. Convenience and ease of doing business trump security. Does that not sound familiar to anybody in here? Like, isn't that sort of the plight of our entire existence, where shadow IT and lots of other things start popping up because it's convenient, or I can get a feature out faster and I don't have to worry about security? And really the analogy that we want to use, or I want to use, is that breaches are more like a hurricane or a flood. It's a temporary thing. So if you can weather the storm, meaning you have enough cash to cover the remediation and a temporary dip in sales, you can survive. You'll be okay. People forget. They'll come back. But the key is that you have to have the right, you know, balance sheet assets in order to do that. And it does impact. Breaches do impact companies. So I don't want you to say, you know, Branden said that breaches don't matter. No, breaches matter, but they matter in a different way. For the most part, brand damage is not really a thing. People still will come back. If there is brand damage, it's temporary. The real damage is the reduction in assets on the balance sheet. And what that does is that curbs any investment plans that maybe were planning all those 30 stores you wanted to open next year. Sorry, you can't do it now. It's going to increase your cost of capital, which means that if I want to borrow money or get lines of credit, it costs me more money. It's sort of a vicious cycle. So it's really not much incentive to be the Fort Knox of whichever industry that you're in. So, you know, we tend to think about security because we're in this arena, right? I think about it a lot, and I really enjoy the people that I meet, and I enjoy the industry, and I enjoy the challenge. But most people aren't like us. I mean, even though there's a lot of people out there, there's a lot of people, more people in business that aren't like us, right? So what do these people think about? Well, HR tends to think about people being important. Finance people, they think about money. Marketing is going to think about branding, you know, maybe lead gen. Sales thinks that bookings and orders, those things are important. IT thinks uptime is important. And the CEO thinks his bonus is important. Now, if we maybe decode that a little bit, he's maybe thinking that he wants to hit and exceed his targets set by the board so he can earn a full bonus. But we'll just say, we'll be a little shallow here. Sorry if you're a CEO. But we know that that's what you think about. So let's go through a scenario. I want you guys to meet Dave, the very handsome-looking fictitious security guy that I pulled off Google Images. He is going to present in his company, and he's presenting this really great security pitch. He's pitching his heart out. I mean, this is the kind of security pitch, like you're listening to this and tears are coming to your eyes. Everybody's nodding, like, this is so great. Dave's got this. Well, hang on a second. Then you get sort of the head pat from the CEO or the CFO, and he says, hey, that's a great presentation, Dave. I really learned a lot. Tell me what you really need. So what the problem was here is that Dave pitched this beautiful thing, but he wasn't really in line with the company's goals. And so he's now this guy's a really smart guy, but he really doesn't sort of fit. He doesn't understand what we're trying to do here. Hopefully that's not any of you. So let's do a couple things here. We're going to go through some corporate initiatives, and we're all going to get to play CFO. I always tell my wife I'm CFO of the household. She's the CEO, of course. Or sometimes the kids are, I guess, but we're going to be the CFO today. So the VP of Operations proposes a $20 million funding request to expand capacity at a processing facility. And what this is going to do, it's going to make way for bigger contracts so we can expand. And it's going to be cash flow positive in 20 months, which means that it's going to be generating more cash than it costs to run it within 20 months. The majority of the expense can be capitalized, which is really important. If you don't know the difference between CapEx and OpEx, be sure to download the resource guide I'm going to show you at the end, because I got a really good refresher in there on what the differences are, and it's important when you're trying to plan your spend. The majority of revenue, oh, I said that, majority expense, revenue generating will be contributing to the fiscal year plus one plan, meaning next year. Next year's plan, we'll get revenue out of this. Sounds pretty good. 20 million, gonna get a long-term flow. Yeah, okay. Next one. VP of Business Development proposes a 15 million funding request, a mix of cash and equity, which is also important, right? Because it's not all cash. You can do things with equity, which is that fake paper money that we give startups sometimes. To pick up a small startup that's patented a process that dramatically improves manufacturing reliability and quality while improving variable costs through cheaper raw materials and faster assembly. There's a lot of like buzzword bingo words in there, I think. We have some more coming up, don't worry. But that looks like a pretty good one too, right? Because now I can corner the market by getting access to this patent and my competitors can't. And it's also going to be super positive for me because I'm going to be able to do some great things. Okay, now let's do the security analytics one, right? So the CISO proposes a $2 million project. That's way less than 20 or 15 million. So, okay. To expand security operations to include advanced security analytics capabilities. The program is an enhancement on basic monitoring in place today and would allow for scaling. In exchange, the CISO is going to pull two full-time employees out of the headcount plan for next year. I don't know, man. Maybe. Kind of depends. Like, you know, in this case, we are actually doing, you know, we're sinking costs, but we are sort of pulling expense out of the business. I don't know, but if you're the CFO and you're looking at those three plans, which one is your least favorite plan? Plan number three. Okay. So these apples to oranges comparisons are really not very easy, and it's hard for a CFO to understand the difference. And security is oftentimes just a cost center, which is, you know, it's unfortunate, but we can figure out ways to fix that. And really, when you look at business, there's only two levers you can pull, right? I can increase revenues on this side, or I can decrease cost. And you know, you probably all know a manager or leader who maybe only knows one of those levers, and hopefully it's the revenue lever. There was actually a really great article that came out based on a book that talked about the three rules of business, and that was one of them was always focus on revenue, don't focus on cost. So increase revenue, reduce cost. But operations folks can still show net positive impact. Okay, so I set up the problem. You're tired of hearing me talk about it. How do I fix it? So the first thing we're not going to do is talk about hacking the boardroom. It's a different talk, probably down the way. But it really is going to start with the mindset here. So in this mindset, security is not the knight riding in on the white horse to save the day. You know, we all know a security guy, hopefully fewer of them exist today, but you know, that walks around carrying the world on his shoulders, right? It's the atlas of the organization. If you guys haven't read The Phoenix Project, you should definitely go get that book and read it, but it's John before the transition, right? Everything's my responsibility. I've got to keep you out of jail. I've got to keep the regulators off of us. I mean, all these things you sort of look at and say, I don't know if that's really true. That's not the attitude that we have to take. We have to remember that we are a function of the business. We are subservient to the business. They're in charge, we're helping them. And we have to move away from this tactical mindset, move more towards strategic and even defense mindset, which is why some people with military experience tend to be really good in security. Ultimately, we have to understand that we're a cost center, and we have to deploy our defenses accordingly. Probably stuff that you have, you know, this is not new. But I'm gonna tell you a story now. My wife is a way better parent than I am. Just in general, she's much more patient with the kids. She's much more caring. I still hug my kids like I'm not that kind of guy, but it's like, you know, she's way better at this you know, job than I am. So several years ago, my son was three. And for those of you who don't have kids and you talk about the terrible twos, those people never had a three-year-old. Three is so much worse than two. Oh my goodness. So it was right in the middle of all that mess. It was late on a Friday. He'd missed his nap, you know, he didn't sleep very well. Maybe he was teething, I don't know. He didn't eat a very good dinner. So you can imagine like this ball of just mess and sobs and tears and throwing stuff, like this is what's happening. And so I'm the kind of guy that when I tell somebody to do something, I sort of expect them to do it, right? In fact, one of the rules in our household is listen first time. And that was actually my wife's rule, not mine, but you know, listen first time. So he was doing something, who knows, you know, I don't know what he was doing, but it's something that annoyed me and I told him to stop. And he stopped for a couple minutes and they went right back and did it again. And I was getting ready to like unleash the yelling of, I told you not to do that. And my wife looks at me and she says, maybe just let that one go. Let's just get to bedtime today. Let's pick our battles on that one. And so the reason why I told you that story is because I think that as a security profession, my personality is the same way. When I see something that's wrong, I want it to be right. I want to fix it, especially if it's happening to someone that I know or happening to me personally. I want it to be right. But that's not always the best pathway forward. It's sometimes not worth it to expend energy to fix things. So when you're looking at all of the things that you have to do as a security professional, you know, don't choose every battle. Pick the ones that are going to be the most relevant and move the needle the farthest. So now, after the story time of how bad of a parent I am, we're going to go through 5 steps. What you see here is the business model canvas. This is a tool that I find very useful. It's included in the resource pack. You can look it up online, lots of literature around it. It works like a Kanban board. Essentially, the best way to do it is to get a whiteboard and draw the scale up on the whiteboard and use sticky notes to do the different functions. We're going to walk through an example here in a second. But the first step that you need to know is, how does your company earn revenue? What markets do you serve? What resources are required to earn that revenue? Well, stick with me. Can you boil your mission down to one sentence? I've got some missions that I've boiled down to one sentence. So let's start with the first one. Airlines. Their mission is to keep planes in the air. If a plane is on the ground, it is not earning money. We need the plane in the air so we can earn money. If we are a bank, keep money working. Keep it moving through the system or lending. If we're an insurance company, this is going to kind of not be nice, but keep claims payouts low. That's the mission. Otherwise, we don't have any money. Last one, hotels. Keep rooms rented. Clearly not a problem this week here in this town. But any room, if there was a room that wasn't rented in this town, is a missed opportunity, missed revenue. So hotels want those rooms rented all the time. So think about that with your company. See if you can come up with that boiled down, 5 to 10 word, what is your mission for your company? So what we're going to do is we're going to go through an example. This is a tech services company. According to the prospectus, 3 or 4 out of every 10 of you belong to this type of a company. So hopefully that audience is in here. If not, then it's another number. But that's okay. We'll all learn something. So tech services company, there's a lot of them out on the floor. They serve, their customer segment is medium to large companies, some outsourced IT, but they're looking for well-capitalized companies and not Fortune 100. So they're not going to go after those big guys. They're going to go sort of in that happy medium right underneath there, okay? The value prop is deliver complete turnkey IT solutions to companies smaller than Fortune 100, okay? Channels. They're going to do OEM stuff, so they're going to go direct from the manufacturer, or they're going to go through advertising and conferences. So maybe we saw some of these guys here today. And from a relationship perspective, they're going to partner with the OEM to be an integration partner. So, companies like Cisco don't really sell direct all the time anymore. They usually use some integration partner to do that work for them. They'll advertise in relevant publications, sponsor vertical-focused events, super basic stuff, but this is, that's the right side of this. Okay, and the revenue streams are people are going to spend money initially, and then they're going to do monthly recurring revenue managed services. Okay, this is like every tech services business model pretty much is right here. The resources, we need partner agreements, we need talent, people, and we need purchase volume so we can get better prices. Some of the activities, we're going to source, build, test, deploy, complete. I mean, literally, like we're going to bring everything into a fake data center. We're going to rack everything up, get it all configured, get it ready to go, use lots and lots of shrink wrap and foam peanuts, and then ship it to the customer. And then they're going to pull it out, cut the stuff off, and have a party. And then there you go, plug it in, ready to go. Here are some partners that they may need to have, some of the big names you know up there. And then the cost structure, 5% margin on hardware, 40% on services. So this is the basic IT tech services business model. This is how they all typically work. It's something very similar to this. So if you were to take the same concept and do it for your company, you're going to have some different answers in there. But you'll be able to see all the different lines and how money moves and how your business works. If you work for a really large company, this can get really complicated. So you may just need to start with like one business line to actually map it out. But once you do this, you're going to have a really good idea of how all the players in that company work in the value stream, is another buzzword bingo, in the value stream, so that you understand how you can play and add value as a security professional. Okay, next. Know your strategy. Does anybody know what that very small, tiny picture that you can't see is? And I'm not going to use the laser pointer because I only got to use it once. This is Walt Disney's map, strategy map, of how he was going to build his empire. And what you, for those that can't see, In the center there is all of the movies and productions, but if you notice, all arrows end up pointing to Disneyland. That was his goal. He wanted everybody to get to Disneyland. This is a very simple strategy map. There's actually a bigger version of this in the resource pack at the end if you want it. So strategy is typically going to fall in one of five areas. The references there on the bottom, these are just generic corporate strategies. Low cost, so it's a basic product, few frills or no frills, and an absolute war on cost. So if I fit into this model, that $3 million or $2 million security analytics purchase is probably not going to happen, because I probably don't have that kind of money for that. Broad differentiation, so this is lots of product variations. Wide selection. Good example of somebody like this would be, pick Samsung. They're having some trouble this week, but if you look at go into Best Buy and you go look at the TVs, I mean, you've got everything from the tiny little, you know, Michael Scott plug into the wall plasma TV to the giant 80-inch curved, beautiful light-up LED thing. Wide variety. Best cost. This is going to be more upscale features, but a good value for the price. So what I like to think about when I think about best cost is a Honda Accord, right? It's not an Acura. It's not a smart car. Sorry, I couldn't think of a junky car. It's not a smart. I'm sorry if you have a smart car. It's not a junky car. Just don't take it on the highway. But it's like a Honda Accord, right? There's some pretty good features in a Honda Accord. It's got power seats. Sometimes they're heated. Sometimes you get a little nav system in there, it's pretty cool. And you get it for a good price. So that's best cost. Now the next two, are gonna be focused. So when you see the word focus, it's talking about a niche. Some people pronounce it niche, and I don't like that, so we're just gonna call it a niche. In a niche, this is a group of people that could be governed by geographical boundaries or age or income level, some demographic that is going to be targeted for your particular product or service. And so a focused low cost niche, that company is going to serve that niche at the lowest possible cost. That's going to be somebody who's very, very cost conscious. The last one is focused differentiation. Frankly, I think everybody wants to be that, because that is the Porsche, that's the Lamborghini, that's the, you know, this is the stuff that whatever that niche is, rich white guys over 40, I guess, that love cars. You know, what's the difference to a guy like that between 180,000 and 210,000? I mean, 30,000, right? But not that much. So I'm going to serve that niche better than anybody else. So price isn't an issue. There's obviously elastic stuff that happens at the end, so price does come in. But focus differentiation, their goal, their entire strategy is to serve that niche better than rivals. So of those five, you think about where your company fits. If you fit in focus differentiation, congratulations, because that $2 million budget's probably yours. If you fit in low cost or focus low cost, good luck. You're going to have to get really creative. But the most important thing is, don't be like Dave and go pitch a big security thing in a low-cost strategy company and get the head pat of, you're such a smart guy, we really like you, but we're not going to do that. More importantly, if you charge a premium, if you're on that focused differentiation or even like a broad differentiation perspective where you can charge a premium, figure out how you can enable that or how you enable that as a security professional. What are you doing in your job for the company that allows you to make sure that you can continue to charge that premium? Okay, next. How am I doing on time? Okay, good, perfect. Understand where and how your firm invests. So airlines, they buy routes or they buy planes. So I don't know if you know this, but if you want to start an airline, you can't just say, oh, I'm in Miami, I'm going to go to Havana. You have to bid on routes. There's only so many routes that work that way, and then you have to, of course, buy a plane, right? So airlines buy routes and planes. Hotel owners buy properties. I'm sure it's no surprise. For those of you that travel, you go to a Marriott. It's probably not owned by Marriott. It's owned by Joe's Hotel Company or whoever it is. Low-cost grocery stores will buy supply chain management efficiency, because what that means is they can now get longer saves. If they buy something that costs them less to transport a good from point A to point B, that is the gift that keeps on giving into perpetuity as long as that's there. So that means they can either improve their margins or they can lower their price to continue to serve that niche. Consumer electronics, well, they buy R&D or patents or whatever, right? So knowing how you invest is a key to money inside of your organization. Would you think that investment plans could be competitive intel? Probably. So it might be something that, you know, around those sorts of competitive plans, how do we add some additional, like, is there a way to leverage an investment to protect competitive intel that we could use across the entire organization? Could you leverage it for other types of security risk stuff? And that's going to lead us to step four, which is knowing your drivers. So people change only when they can't tolerate the pain or consequences of not changing. And the little thing that you maybe can't read there is, unless you're my mother, because I swear to God, once every 3 weeks, the living room furniture was completely rearranged and something new. I don't know why. I thought it was fine, but whatever. So you have to understand what's driving the change, though. So could it be something like compliance or regulatory? If you were a retailer in the last 10 years, you probably can think of one compliance thing that forced you to change a lot of what you were doing. It could be the market. It could be that somebody, a competitor, came in with a better product. Or it could be that there is now, you know, an increase or decrease in raw materials that you have to account for. Could be just management saying, you know, we want to spend less, or we want to invest here, we want to do this differently, we have different goals for us this year. But you shouldn't rely only on your skills. So, you know, think about other areas in the company. Now, this is going to, I know some of you are going to get a little anxiety when I put the next slide up, but does branding or sales, do they care about breaches? They do, because they're programmed to say, yes, the breaches are bad for our brand, even though it's probably not true. Could you enter riskier markets because you're really good at information security? We're going to go through a case study on this one. And the last thing to think about is what's on their sheet. So I did a negotiation seminar, and we did buyers and sellers, right? And so you got your little sheet that said, here's the scenario and here's your constraints, and you had to negotiate a deal. In your company, everybody has a sheet like that, right? Now, people often think that buyers have all the power, and that's not true, because what you'd find on a buyer's sheet is, I have to fill this headcount or I'm going to lose it for next year. I have to buy this product because compliance has given me a red flag on an audit, and I don't want to turn from yellow to red. I'm going to lose this budget if I don't spend this money. From a seller's perspective, if I don't sell this thing, I'm not going to make club, or I'm not going to make my number, or I can't buy the boat that I've had my eye on at the boat show. Both people have stuff on their sheet. So when you're talking to people in other parts of your organization, try to understand what their constraints are and understand what's on their sheet. So that's going to lead us to this very anxiety-ridden slide, which is making partnerships and executing. But it means that you have to talk to people, and I know we typically don't like to do that. Many of us are introverted and don't like talking to people, but you're going to have to talk to people. Most importantly, you should be going to the source. And what I mean by that is, don't take IT or audit's word for something. You really need to, and don't let them speak on your behalf as well. So I'll give you an example. See if this sounds familiar to anybody in here. Looking at a data store, this particular database was being decommissioned, and they said, well, we have to keep it for 7 years. Well, why do you have to keep the data for 7 years? Well, because audit told us we had to keep it for 7 years. So then we go to audit. Well, no, legal told us we had to keep it for 7 years. So I go to the lawyers and I say, okay, can you please show me the legal statute, case law, contract, whatever that says we are mandated to keep and exactly what we're required to keep for 7 years? Then all of that stuff happens and realize, oh yeah, we didn't have to keep that stuff for 7 years. We had to keep something else for 7 years. So don't take people's words for it. Don't let them speak on your behalf. And then propel the business and your objectives, right? So finding allies that you can add your stuff to in the organization, which is that baked in, not bolted on. You've got some new initiative, something going on. Can you add some security stuff to it? I don't think there's anything riskier than using red Comic Sans in an RSA presentation. We're talking about enabling riskier ways to do business. Turning your center of excellence into a revenue generator. You guys probably have processes and things that you do from a security perspective that could actually generate revenue. Whether you spin it out, or you make a product out of it, or you sell it to another company, or even you use it for goodwill and you think about what Netflix does and they just sort of open source a lot of their tools. Walmart just did it with some of their orchestration stuff. You can have a positive impact to your company in security and not just be that cost center. Okay, so be the CFO revisited, three scenarios. First one, CFO is pushing a cost-cutting initiative across the company to free up capital for next year's initiatives. A company loosely follows best costs, so value products at a good price. They identify an investment in the tool set today allows you to decommission three other products for a net save of $1 million over 3 years, including headcount. Looks pretty good. That's a good one. Okay, now let's use driver as an example. CEO is asking each business lead to increase revenue by 10% to account for shortfalls in the key product line. South America vice president has found a risky opportunity in Brazil, but council repeatedly advises against it due to their position on IP law. Brazil is not a really great place for intellectual property law. Could we leverage security analytics tools and allow this business to operate in a hostile environment? Maybe, right? could be positive. Now, of course, we don't have time on our side with that, but, you know, it's an example. Now, here's another one that I really like. So SSO Federation. So VP of IT needs to reduce help desk costs. Do you guys ever think about how much it costs to reset a password in your company? So it's a good metric, right? And it's actually something that if you think about how to pull a lot of expense out of the business, that's one way to do it if we can automate password resets or do stuff around password resets. So in this particular case, password policy stipulated that each application internal must have a unique ID, but the way it was implemented, that everybody has a different password. So it could be an approach for single sign-on or federation, an investment there that would improve user experience, it improves security for identity and access management, and also it's going to reduce that the amount of $10 per reset that we see. And $10 per reset is a cost I kind of pulled out doing some basic research, but you know, go look in your company, I bet you it's pretty close. In the way you'd calculate it is, how long do those calls take, what's the salary of the person you're paying, what are all the fixed costs of the building and the phone lines and the staffing and all that stuff. And then you know, you could also add in, if you wanted to, lost wages, lost productivity, and all that kind of stuff, but that's funny money, so just be careful. Okay, so here's our magical apply slide that you see in every presentation. Next week, you should identify the top three priorities for your company. Those are not hard to find. You'll find those in strategy statements, market statements. If you're a private company, then if you have a good CEO, good leader, they've probably told you what our top priorities are for the year. It's a big rallying point kickoff in January. Do they align with your top three? If they don't, guess what? You're out on the edges. You're not in the center of the current here. The first 3 months following the presentation, gain a good understanding of how your company works and generates revenue. You should be able to fill out a pretty solid business model canvas in a few hours if you really had to think about it. You may have to go ask some questions, but as you refine it, you're going to have a really good understanding of how your business works. And connect with 5 business leaders and influencers and learn their top 3 priorities. If they're doing their jobs right, their top 3 are going to align to the top 3 of the company, which means that your top 3 should align to those top 3. And then within 6 months, you should make that pitch. Build a plan and rebalance your priorities based on what you learn. Maybe you don't have it right. Or maybe you do have it right and you found some investments and things you can do. Build security into another corporate initiative. So could single sign-on or federation, could that be a quick win? You know, it's easier for users to do that. We have less risks around passwords. We all know and love passwords, so maybe we can do something about that. And finally, find a creative way to solve a security problem that helps to save expense dollars. Okay, so as I promised, this is how you get the resources. You send a blank email to the letter b@zip.sh with the subject RSA 2017. It'll come back with the link. You can download the materials there. I didn't put the QR code on it this time because that always is very awkward. So at this point, I'd like to open it up for questions. There we go. It only takes one.
Can you please repeat the name of the book that you mentioned about Phoenix?
The Phoenix Project.
Thank you.
That's this generation's version of The Goal, which is an operations management book. But it's a very fantastic book. Came out a few years ago. A lot of DevOps techniques, security, all kinds of fun stuff. That was a softball question, but thank you. Oh, yes. Absolutely. Yeah. Go ahead.
Hi. Do you think this approach also works for, like, government organizations that have a budget at the beginning of the year and do not have revenue and all that stuff?
So yes, it does, because that government organization has a mission, right? That's what each organization typically in that space, they have a mission. So you can align everything you're doing towards that mission. When you look at, you talk about revenue and that other type of stuff, I understand that can be challenging, but you're in that service sort of space, so you'd be focused more on getting creative with the dollars that you do get, and you know, hopefully you get to grow your budget over time as well. That's a really great question. So it not always 100% because of the lack of revenue, and there may be legal reasons why you can't actually generate some types of revenue, but you can apply a lot of it. I mean, you can talk to other people and figure out, because if you know what your budget is, do you know what somebody else's budget is, and could you guys pool money together to solve a problem, you know, something helping them, helping you at the same time?
Okay, thanks.
Thanks. Nobody else wants to be brave? Yeah.
Hi, I'm a student in Korea, and you said that we should interchange with influential people in presentation, but isn't it difficult to make with relationship with those people? Is there any special things for that? Or can you give me some tips or know-how?
So yeah, and I think this is something that I'm fairly passionate about, because I think that security people do need to talk to more people. So like the easiest tip I can give you is, once you figure out, you'll figure out who an influencer or who somebody important is by listening to who people talk about. And you can approach that person, and you can offer to buy them coffee or buy them a drink or whatever, and ask them questions about themselves. So in general, people like to talk, and they like to talk about themselves. And if you ask them questions about themselves and about their business, they'll usually open up and tell you all kinds of things. So that's probably the easiest way. It doesn't work in all scenarios, but it works really often, you know, just going and asking for coffee or for drinks.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks.
First, thanks for the talk. Good insights.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. A question that I have was, I note that, in a good way, that most of this is like a positive track, positive reinforcement, trying to improve case security in the way of improving the business and so on. But I do notice that there's not really anything about using the other side of the equation, which is, if we don't get secure, XYZ is going to happen. And I'm not a proponent of FUD. I don't like that. But the fact of the matter is, most of the time, that's the most effective stick that I see that we have, is that if we don't secure control, XYZ is going to cost us $10 million if we get breached. Now, the problem is being able to prove that that's going to happen. So I was wondering if you had any comments of effective ways, metrics, or any way to make the case for buying security control XYZ or commissioning project ABC because it's going to, you know, defray costs XYZ.
Yep. So that's a great question. And you're right. We didn't focus on any of the stick methods. I like the carrot method a lot better. But so I think that there's a couple instances where you sometimes have to have that conversation, right? It's better if you can tie it to some sort of punitive action, like a fine or something. If you know, when you think about breaches, unfortunately, because it's this sort of like fictitious, like it could happen to us, but it probably gonna happen to that guy before it happens to us. You know, it's really hard to make a prediction. So I don't like any of those the annualized lost expectancy stuff. Like those numbers just seem kind of fake to me. I apologize if Larry's in the room or if you are friends with Larry Poneman, but I don't like his cost per record. I think that data set is very flat. So there's numbers that are like, you know, $100,000 per record, and there's numbers that are 30 cents per record, and we say average 212, and then you take that and multiply, and bad things happen. So I think in the case there, if you can show from an operations perspective, the last thing you said was, you know, you can save down the road, right? I can save money down the road. That's a real business case. You can say, if you give me $1 million today, I can pull $3 million out later on because we've solved these three problems, right? Or we can cut this vendor, or we can do this other thing. To me, it still sounds positive, I think, but that's the way I would approach it. If you have a legal thing, legal's pretty easy, right? Get the lawyer in there to tell them that. And if it's some, you know, hoping we don't have a breach, it's really challenging. Thanks for the question. Go ahead.
This question turns out to be a follow-on. Have you looked at any quantitative methods? There's a couple, two or three out there. And do you have any recommendations or had any experience with any of the quantitative methods of measuring risk to the business due to IT?
Yeah, so I have. And my problem always, so I think that it's a great exercise to go through because it at least gets pen to paper. But it's hard to prove those numbers. It's hard to prove them as being real. And I think that's where the challenge is, because unless you're willing to train the board on that methodology and all the ins and outs of that methodology, it's gonna be hard, right? Because it's easier for you to tell them in dollars and cents, make this investment here, I'll give you this much back in my plan, or I'm gonna do this, we're gonna do that, as opposed to, well, this risk over here is this many dollars, and so therefore we should spend this to cover, you know. I don't even like the ones that say, There's a stat that you can get by industry. I don't know if it's by SIC code or NAICS or something, but like the percentage of revenue that is spent on security. You know, you can get, I don't even like that number because, well, Walmart and Target are two different companies. Why? So they should have different numbers, right? JP Morgan and Bank of America, they're different banks. They should have different numbers. Why would I use it as a benchmark? So I think it's a good exercise to go through. I just don't like to use that as my mechanism to show this is why we need to do something, because I feel like I'd have to train them all. They're gonna call BS on it and tell me I don't know what I'm talking about. That's a great question, though. Go ahead.
Yeah, thanks for sharing the insight. In the many of your examples of the breach that you showed us, I think you skipped to demonstrate the Sony, right? Mm-hmm. But you know, to your point, I think Sony stock almost doubled, you know, from it was breached.
That's right.
So the story that you know we're telling to our executives, you know, all this company being breached, but you know, that looks like they're increasing in value. It's a good publicity, right?
Yeah.
So like, you know, how do we reverse it, right, to kind of scare them?
Well, so that's what I'm saying. Like, I don't like to scare them, but. So this whole, I changed my entire view towards this. So by 2007, I was sitting in front of a CFO of a very prominent company here. So I think they're still around. You know, companies come and go over here all the time. It wasn't a tech company. And we were talking about the TJX breach, and I was talking about how, you know, the brand damage is terrible, like this is awful. And he called me to the carpet, and he said, did you look at their stock the day they announced the breach? Because the stock price closed up, right, not down. So don't tell me that a breach is going to cause me all this financial harm and it's going to be negative to my balance sheet. So, I mean, he was really mad. So I, you know, calmed down, thought about it, and it, you know, you're right. Like, it's later down the line. It's the remediation. It's the lawyers. It's the settlements. It's all that other stuff that removes cash from the balance sheet and then goes outside the organization. So that's why, you know, it comes back to that sort of flood, hurricane type. You can weather the natural disaster, then you'll be in a better spot.
And the other point I, you know, I'd like to make, I don't know if you have any insight on that, is that you talk about a lot of aligning your staff with the strategy, you know, company goals, right? Usually those are being defined for, you know, short-term, long-term, 3 to 5 years, right?
Yep.
So while our development cycles shift from, you know, waterfall to agile, our budgets are, you know, still waterfall, right? You know, we budget for a year or two or three. So it's very difficult, you know, to start readjusting your projects following your agile methodology if your budget and finance are, you know, set for a year. So I'm not sure what you've done in that case.
So that to me, that requires conversations with your CFO office, like, okay, help me.
Right.
You know, basically what we're doing is we're Adobe right now, like several years ago, right? So we're moving away from $1,500 for the creative suite to $50 a month. This is a massive transition, and it's going to change everything about how we do money. So
I mean, you're shifting the subscription model, basically.
Exactly,
right?
Yeah. Okay. And so, but that's what you're doing with Agile as well. It's like, right, we're not allocating, you know, five releases with this many dollars. We're saying, no. It's continuous deployment, it's continuous improvement, it's these things.
Right.
So I would work with your, I mean, we're not CFOs, right? For a really good reason. So work with those guys and they'll be able to help you.
Okay, so basically shifting from CapEx into OpEx model.
Yes, that's exactly, okay, what, in a lot of cases that's what you're doing, yeah.
All right, cool, thanks.
Thank you for the question. I think it's the last one, yep.
Great presentation. I think just to add to, you know, first of all, everybody needs to know how the company makes money.
Mm-hmm.
Hands down, that's needed. I think what also helps in my case, in our organization, if you have a ethical hackers team or a red team, once you've determined where you make money and what's the channel, have a ethical hack inside, right? And show the maturity of your controls. And,
yep,
and that speaks volume in terms of putting presentations compared to putting PowerPoint presentations,
yep,
so on and so forth. That's really getting down to the details. Second is, I know you talked about outside third-party assessment and doing an industry sort of comparison as to how you benchmark against, or how you stack up against the benchmark outside. A lot of times, as you said, it's very difficult to push somebody to change something until they feel very uncomfortable, or at least have a competitive view of, is competition doing this? You want to just be fast enough to outrun your competition when the bear is chasing you down, right? That's the game. So it does help to have an external assessor come in and do an assessment and show you. It also helps to get, if you have a red team or whatever, to just go out and sort of emulate a breach.
Yeah, no, that's a great point. I mean, and to that point, you know, a lot of people say money solves all problems, and I completely disagree with that, because at some point, you sort of look at a Keynesian economic graph, right, where you've got, you know, more money gets you better things, until a certain point where you could spend thousands and millions more, but you don't really get a better security posture, right? So the trick is to stay just below that curve to where you're, you know, still getting a little bit of benefit, but you're not just throwing money away. So, yeah, thanks. So thanks, everybody. I appreciate it. Happy Friday. We'll see you.